10 years to ram it through. In fact, 10 years ago, the mainstream media said it didn't exist. Now they admit it merges the North American Union and the European Union with the Asian Union. It's the TPP. It's already been ratified by secret corporate groups. U.S. polls showed that upwards of 90% of Americans were against it. Congress wasn't even allowed to read it, but one page at a time in a secret room. And after it was voted down repeatedly in the House, it finally passed earlier this week. And today, just minutes ago, it passed the Senate. And the media spun it like it was a victory for Obama and his legacy. His legacy, like it's a football game, like the New England Patriots won something. This is, in the 240-year history of this country, the biggest blow to our sovereignty ever. We've got three sections of it that have been leaked by WikiLeaks. Another 25 are secret. Those three sections alone make the president a dictator. Congress has no legislative control over borders, over trade, over finances, over currency. It is truly mind-blowing. And Congress is so blackmailed, so controlled, it was rammed through. To the Democrats' credit, a lot of them in the House and Senate voted against it, along with the Tea Party. But the Republican establishment, Democratic establishment, combined forces yet again against the American people. Look, in the past, armies conquered nations. Now it's these corporate boards. It's all through fraud. We can expect to be looted. We can expect to have our laws made in secret, just like the people of the European Union. This is a very sad day for America. It's so surreal. It's so breathtaking. I have trouble myself believing it happened. I was so excited last week when there was incredible pressure on the House and they voted it down. But Obama traveled to the Hill, twisted arms, and got a bunch of Democrats to go over to him. They used the whole Confederate battle flag diversion as a way to get people obsessed on that. And we took it hook, line, and sinker. Now is the fight to try to stop them from fully implementing it. But the whole thing's secret in perpetuity, so how do you fight something that's invisible? It's stealth. And that's what the North American Union documents talked about that got released by Judicial Watch when they sued back in 2007, was that it's North American integration by stealth, and that they would then integrate North America with the other unions by stealth as well. That's in the document I cover in my film, Endgame Blueprint for Global Enslavement. We'll be on the radio tomorrow, 11 a.m. to 2 p.m., talking about this issue. But understand, the bottom's now fallen out. The government's gone full tyranny, and nothing is stopping them now because of the blackmail, the insider trading, whatever it is. Katie barred the door. All over the world, governments are pledging their support to the big six mega banks, and we are headed towards world government. The Pope has called for a global government. Everybody's calling for one in the establishment. It is a unified front, left, right, and center, to bring in an unelected, secretive, planetary corporate government. We have been conquered by Goldman Sachs and J.P. Morgan and the Bank of England. This country that was somewhat free since our revolution of 1776 wasn't perfect, but became the apple of the world's eye because we had more freedom than others, has now sunk into the mud. And this is a devastating blow. While we were busy complaining about Confederate flags and sex changes for Jenner, while we were busy entranced by the television, our country was stolen. As Thomas Jefferson warned, if private central banks are ever allowed to issue the currency, our grandchildren will wake up homeless on the continent our forebears conquered. I'm Alex Jones from the front lines of the info war. The tyranny is just starting, but humanity fighting back has just begun.
All right, that's Alex Jones. That's a recorded message that you can see on YouTube as well as the InfoWars channel. We're going to be talking more about what this means. When we come back, we're also going to be talking about the new Supreme Court decision on Obamacare. We've got Obama trade. We've got extensions of Obamacare. Stay with us. We're going to break that down for you when we get back. Alex pointed out in the clip that we played in the first segment, the TPA has passed. It passed yesterday evening, of course. They knew that was going to pass. They had it worked out on the Senate schedule. They said that they were going to hold the vote at 5:33 p.m. Not 5:30, 5:33 p.m. They've had a very detailed playbook to get this through. They've managed to distract the public. The public just isn't interested. They've got too many entertainment issues that are out there, too many things like racism, the charges that are going on. And there's real racism. We need to talk about it. But what's going on with the Confederate flag? We're going to talk about that later in the show as well. But they've managed to keep people distracted while this is going through. They had this precisely planned as to what they were going to do. The vote the day before was to shut cloture, to make sure there wasn't going to be any debate. There wasn't going to be any filibuster going on with this. This is what's happened the entire way through. Everything that the Senate and the House have done is to accelerate the process. And so we see this thing, and it's actually America that's going downhill, like some kind of a soapbox derby, where the gravity is gradually picking up. We're gradually accelerating. Every single step of this has been to accelerate it. Now, they have still not passed the TPP or the TTIP or any of these other traps that they're working on. They haven't passed those yet. But as this thing picks up momentum, it is going to be increasingly hard because of the inertia of this to try to turn this thing around to stop it. Because everything about this trade promotion fast track bill was set up to make sure that it could not be stopped. That was the design of it. The fundamental lie at the bottom of all this was that it was not a treaty, because a treaty would require 67 votes in the Senate. The House would not even be involved in that. That's the process. But they did it anyway. They conveniently ignored that it's a treaty. Senator Sessions, who looked at this, said it is a treaty. He pointed out a lot of things that are going to be problems with it. Now, the TPP is hidden. The TTIP is hidden. We've had some leaks of those. We know precisely, however, what is in this Trade Promotion Authority, this fast-track process that they've run through. Some of the issues that they're going to do with this. Now, they're not going, whenever they've got this treaty that they've been working on in secret with corporate lobbyists for years, when they're done with that, they're going to bring it to the legislative bodies, and they're going to say, we're not going to go through the usual process. Typically, a bill, remember Schoolhouse Rocks? They talked about how a bill becomes a law. You know, you take it to a committee, the committee takes a look at it, they recommend it to the floor for a vote, the leader recommends it to the floor for a vote. No, none of that. The fast-tracked authority says that once they present us with this document, or present the Congress with the document, they will take it immediately to the, they'll take it to the floor no less than 45 days. They can take it sooner, but no more than 45 days. It doesn't have to go through the committee. It doesn't have to go through the leader. They can accelerate the process, but they cannot slow it down. Once it goes to the floor, there will be no filibuster by the Senate. There will be debate, but limited to 20 hours. 20 hours. No more than 20 hours. There will be no amendments made to it by the legislative bodies. Our representatives, theoretically, who had nothing to do with writing it, they will not be able to amend it. Once it is passed, however, as Senator Sessions has pointed out, it will be infinitely malleable. There will be a transnational council committee that is part of these trade agreements, these trade treaties. They will be able to amend it. They will be able to add China to it if they wish. Because that's important, because it was sold to us as a check against Chinese power. We needed to make common markets with these Asian economies so that we could have a counterbalance to China. Look, they don't want a counterbalance to China. They'll bring China in. China's going to continue selling their slave goods to Walmart. Of course, they won't be making Confederate flags, I guess, anymore in China. But they will still use their slaves. China, Walmart will be able to disavow any outright ownership of the slaves. They don't have to take care of them. They evidently don't have to take responsibility for them. They'll bring them in and you'll buy their slave goods, because they have run all the mom and pop stores out of business across the country. But this is going to be a situation, once these trade partnerships, they used to call them agreements, until they passed them. You know, when they passed NAFTA, NAFTA was a trade agreement. But once they passed it, it became a treaty. When you look at these investor state arbitration processes that are established by these multinational economic treaties that they're putting through, and we have those already in place. We have those in place in the European Union. We have them in place in NAFTA. It's not a theory as to how this is going to play out. We've seen how it plays out. They elevate the multinational corporations to the level of government. I would say higher than the level of government. We can look at how one of these is playing out right now in Australia, for example. They passed some legislation that put some pretty strong warnings on cigarette packages. So strong, in fact, that the sales of big tobacco in Australia took a big hit. So they went to one of these investor state arbitration processes and said, look, your new labels are costing us sales. So we demand payment in this arbitration process of billions of dollars from the taxpayers. That's the way it's going to work out with GMO labeling. We're going to have Anthony Gucciardi talk about the implications of that. At the fundamental level, this is about corporations forcing us to buy their products. That's one level of it. Of course, the other level of it is the loss of jobs that we've seen how these things work out with NAFTA. That's one aspect of it. But it's also them holding a gun to our heads and saying, you're going to continue to buy my GMO products. You can't ban those. You can't even label them because that would hurt my sales. And if you do that, you're just going to pay me billions and billions of dollars in penalties. So our legislators will kind of back down on that. You know, we support our operation here without holding a gun to your head. Actually, we'll talk about these buckles. You can hold a gun to your belly. How's that? You can put it on a belt buckle. And we've got a special going on right now with the Milan Lave silver belt buckles, as well as the M16. There are two different designs you can look at. They are normally $50. They're limited runs. They're on sale right now for $20. And these are a couple of designs that Alex Jones put together. I guess it's still allowed that we can use Greek symbols against tyranny. We can't use Southern symbols against tyranny. But I guess Greek is still allowed. And you can still put pictures of guns on your stomach and you can your belt buckle. And so you can talk to other people about that. It's a good way to support our operation. And it's a good way to get conversation going out there. Plus, they look really good. And you can get them, as I pointed out, for $20 off. It's limited run. 500 of one of them and 700 of the other. They are numbered on the back as well as with the Made in 1776 logo. But that's not the way the multinational corporations operate. We can see this in the Supreme Court decision today with Obamacare. Of course, Obamacare fundamentally was about using the power of government to hold a gun to your head and mandate that you buy their services. Now, the first time this came through, Roberts wrote both opinions. Very interesting, wasn't it? And I've mentioned many times, many other people have said it as well. We believe, many of us, and I'm one of them, believe that Roberts was blackmailed to do that. That's a very unusual move. First, he wrote an opinion saying, no, you can't have Obamacare because the government can't force you to buy products of private companies. Then he came back and said, no, never mind, it's a tax. So he wrote both the dissenting and the prevailing opinion in that. The idea being that it is not a tax if you're paying the money to a corporation. What they did was they said, buy this insurance in the way that we are dictating it, or you will have to pay a penalty to us. But that's not a tax. A tax would be money that you paid directly to the government. So they play games with the language. It's very malleable as far as they're concerned. It's just like they call these treaties trade agreements, or they call them partnerships. But once they pass them, when they go to these arbitration processes, like I was just describing, they have the lawyers who specialize in this say that their specialty is treaty law, not trade agreement law, treaty law. And they talk about these arbitration processes as being treaty claim. You see, a treaty is an agreement between one or more nations about commerce, about peace, about a variety of issues. This is a treaty. It should have been voted on by 67 people in the Senate. So they have played these prevaricating games, these nonsense games, to even get it to the point where we are now. So it's not a good sign. What it is a sign of is that these guys are willing to lie to the public. They're willing to do anything for their corporate masters. Why haven't they bothered to look at this secret trade agreement? They don't need to. They've been told by the people who control them, by the people that they work for, and it's not you. They don't work for you. They don't listen to you. They're not responsible to you. These people are the ones who send them the money. These people are the ones who keep them in power. And so they've been told how to vote. They don't need to read this. They could care less what it says. They're just doing what they're told. Breitbart says, Marco Rubio cast the deciding vote for Obama trade without even reading it. Guess what? It was 60 votes that they did to shut cloture. It was 60 votes to pass the Trade Promotion Authority. Now, the trade bill has actually not passed, but again, it's going to be very, very hard to stop it. So that's why many people just take it to the next step and talk about it as if it had passed. We need to understand that it has not passed. We need to understand they still have not voted in the TPP or the TTIP, the Transatlantic or the Trans-Pacific treaties. And we need to put all the pressure we can on these people. Of course, Marco Rubio cast the deciding vote. 60 was exactly what they needed. Every one of the senators who voted for this cast the deciding vote. And I have to say, the first time it came through, we're very critical of Ted Cruz. Yeah, I think he heard that pushback. He pretended his explanation was phony, but at least he did the right thing. At least he listened to the people. At least he changed his vote. We don't want to throw him under the bus too hard, too far, because we need 10 or 11 more like that to stop this at the next level. Stay with us. We're going to be right back. We're going to be joined in the next segment with Anthony Gucciardi. He's going to talk about one of the many aspects of this Trans-Pacific Partnership, Transatlantic Partnership, these trade bills, they call them, that are being run through, but they're about a lot more than that. It's not really Obama trade. It's really Monsanto trade. It's really Merck trade. It's really Goldman Sachs trade, because those are the corporations that wrote it. It's just that Obama and Mitch McConnell, the leadership of the both parties, who do exactly as they're told, they're just ramming this through for those people. Now, he's been given dictatorial powers. Of course, the U.S. Trade Representative has been given the power to rewrite our economy, essentially, because there's so many different things that aren't even based on trade and economics. It would be bad enough if that was all it was. I would oppose it just on that basis alone, looking at what's happened with NAFTA. But just as we've seen with NAFTA, you're wondering why the borders are open? Maybe you didn't see the secret memos about what's going on with the North American Union, or listen to David Petraeus saying, what comes after America? It's easy, North America. We're 20 years into NAFTA. They're rolling this out not just as an economic screw job. It's not just that they're exporting your jobs, importing workers. No, it's far worse than that. They are consolidating the different groups, the different nations into economic trade blocks. Once they do that, then they start to push for political union. Senator Sessions, who's looked at these new bills, and they may be more explicit, may be on a faster track, as I pointed out earlier. This is something that is accelerating. Just like a soapbox racer going down the hill, it is going faster and faster. They're going to put these things together in economic situation, as well as what we're seeing going on with Greece and others right now in the European Union. We've got a lot of people in the European Union not happy about what they're seeing with this. The economics of it are awful. It has been an economic union as well as a trade union, but now they are calling for and saying the only way that they're going to solve this is for the states to surrender sovereignty to the European Union. So once they get us into these trade blocks, into these economic blocks, then it becomes a political block, and then they will join these political blocks together. That's always been the plan. Go back 45 years. Look at what Zbigniew Brzezinski was laying out with a trilateral commission. What did he see? He saw three different areas. That mirrors exactly what's going on with these partnerships. And of course, the common backbone that all this is being hooked to is the United States, because that's where the globalists are the most entrenched, is right here in the United States. We had the former Fed chair, Greenspan, as well as the fellow who runs the largest bond company in the world, PIMCO, both saying that in order to solve these economic situations that are going on in Europe, because it's not just Greece, there's the pigs, there's Portugal, Italy, Ireland, Greece, Spain, all of them, they're going to be coming at eventually. All of these peripheral areas have to be made to serve the interests of the core countries and the central banks that run them. So they're going to not only continue with the economic union, but now they're saying in order for the economic union to work, we have to have a political union. They have to surrender sovereignty to the center. Now, with all the talk that we've had about the Confederate flag, what people haven't been talking about is exactly the parallel to what happened in our country. We can see this consolidation, this movement to the center. Lord Acton, who said, power corrupts, absolute power corrupts, absolutely. He was concerned primarily about the consolidation, the concentration of power. That's what the founders of this country were concerned about as well. They understood that was how tyranny would come to us, would be in consolidation of power. We saw that happen with the Civil War. We saw a government that was created by sovereign states gradually move from a war of independence to Articles of Confederation to a union to an empire under Lincoln. Yes, when he crossed the Rubicon and it became an empire was when he crossed the Potomac. And we have seen a consolidation of an American empire. You want to know how this is going to happen in the future? As Orwell said, he who wants to control the future controls the past. And those who control the present control the past. They know that they are going to continue to consolidate this in the same way that sovereign nations created the United Nations. And now the United Nations is increasingly making demands and plans for all of us, asserting its authority. That's the way it's going to go down. You think you want to get out of the UN? At one point, they're going to say, no, you can't leave. Maybe they're going to come up with something so draconian that people want to get out. It's like, you can't dissolve this. You have no right of secession. That's what will happen with these trade agreements. Our congressmen have signed over their authority to an international committee that will continue to modify this independent of any input from our elected representatives. Stay with us. We'll be right back talking about more implications. Joining me in the studio is Anthony Gucciardi. We're going to talk about one more aspect of these trade partnerships. I call them, they're not free trade. They're actually a bunch of traders who are running free in Congress is really what's going on with this. Also, in the next hour, we're going to be talking, we're going to have a special report from Alex Jones because, of course, this is the fast-track trade treaty. They are getting this faster and faster. The momentum is building. The inertia is building. But they still have not passed one of these secret trade agreements yet. So we've got a video report from Alex Jones talking about how we can stop this. Look, we don't know what's going to happen with any of this stuff, but we see all of these different aspects converging on us. We had just a week ago, we had the Pope talking about global warming, making that an issue, putting out an encyclical, which is a pretty heavy endorsement from the Pope on a global governance. And that's what that was a part of. We're going to break that down for you. We've got a report coming up in just a couple of minutes from Rex Jones, our reporter, talking about global warming. So they're coming at world government from a variety of different issues. We don't know really what the future is going to hold, when things are going to collapse. We see economic problems building in Europe. We see economic problems building here. If you haven't prepared yourself, and part of that preparation is preparing your body, preparing your health to make sure that you're in as good a possible physical condition if we have some kind of a systemic economic collapse, making sure that you have stockpiled products, you're crazy if you haven't started doing that. I try to take care of myself. I take nascent iodine every day. We've got a special on X2 nascent iodine right now. You can see that at the InfoWars store. We don't know, as I said, what's coming up, but right now is the time that you need to take advantage of the opportunity to store this, to prepare for this. Just like you're preparing food, you need to make sure that you've got supplements and things that are going to help you to set aside the things that you'll need to have in place once we have a breakdown, once there is an economic collapse. Or if it is just something like an emergency where you cannot get to the stores and restock. Joining us now is Anthony Gucciardi. Anthony, you've got an article up on Infowars.com. Senate passes TPP fast-tracking that could make GMO labeling illegal. Tell us about that aspect of it.
Well, you know, I was just thinking about it before coming on air, and I think one of the most powerful weapons of the TPP is that its implication is so confusing to people.
Yeah.
Right? And it takes so much time to research because you're like, what is this TPA? So just to catch everyone up to speed, the TPA is what was passed on Tuesday, right? Yeah. And what that does is it gives blanket authority for President Obama to come in and say, well, here's what we want to do from the White House, you know, with our trade partners, our foreign national trade partners. We want to come in and do this, this, and this, and give corporations this much power and do that and that. And Congress can't change it in any way.
Yes.
They can either approve it, which historically they always will. Any trade promotions, they will always approve, or they can shut it down. So,
and it puts a time limit. It says you will vote on this immediately, essentially, within 45 right. days. And we know how that's played out. When we looked at Obamacare, they dumped this 1,000-plus page document on these guys and say, you've got 24 hours, we're going to vote on it. I mean, that's how this is going to come down. Then they'll be able to say, oh, they put that on me so quickly, I didn't have time to read it.
And we're still not going to be able to read it anyway.
Right.
Right? Until it's approved. And one of the most interesting things is the small portion of this that has become available of the TPP One of the most shocking and disturbing things about it to me is how it gives Monsanto the ability, and nations like the United States, which have been caught paying for Monsanto's marketing materials overseas, right? The U.S. Yes. State Department was caught by WikiLeaks in 2011. And I wish it was 2009, but it was found out in 2011. They were paying for marketing materials overseas for Monsanto, okay, so they could expand. And they were threatening trade wars mm-hmm. against countries that wouldn't accept biotechnology. Mm-hmm. And it was really bad. They were threatening Spain. There was different groups, even religious groups, threatening different sanctions against those who wouldn't accept Monsanto's GMOs. And now the TPP is just an extension, an octopus extension of that, grabbing everything together. And it's now allowing for Monsanto to dictate its own rules and the U.S. government to dictate its own systems where GMO labeling could actually become illegal. So it doesn't matter if we decide as a state to label GMOs because over 90% of the United States public is in favor of it. The TPP would shut that down. And just if you don't even care about GMOs, imagine the implications on a greater scale, right? What you're not allowed to know if you're inhaling jet fuel or something when you're using some other product.
Right.
This could shut down everything. This could set us back hundreds of years in terms of actual health laws that are meant to protect us.
Well, it could apply to big tobacco as well. And as you're talking about this, you know, whether or not it's a law that actually prohibits it. So the way that it'll work out is that it will create a trade war, or they will go to this investor state arbitration process and they will get billions and billions of dollars from the people in those countries, because we have many countries where they have outlawed GMOs. They understand that. They put restrictions on it, or they put labeling. They don't want to fight this. They want to transcend this. And that's what this transnational agreement is about. We've seen it happen with GMO labeling and with the prohibitions on GMO farming being done in communities, being done in states. They don't want to fight that. So they started working to fight it at the national level. This is hopping over that to go to the transnational level.
Exactly. And then they argue, oh, well, if we don't do this, then we'll have to adopt China's trade policies. Have you heard that argument as well?
Yeah, right.
So, okay. So we either accept a carte blanche, everything that's going to shut down GMO labeling and restrict our abilities to know anything about the food we're eating and restrict our abilities to do anything with multinational corporations, gives them a massive shielding against all liability, or we just accept a communist nation's 100% law. That does not sound like reasonable options for me.
Well, it's nonsense anyway. They always offer us a false dichotomy.
Of course.
They say, look, it's going to be this or it's going to be this. So you need to pick this.
It's like if you're getting stabbed with a knife and they say, well, we could shoot you with 55 shotguns at the same time. Which one would you rather have? It makes getting stabbed with a knife not seem as bad, right?
Yeah, exactly. They know that. That's why they say, well, you know, you really don't want to have China setting the rules. You really don't want them in a preeminent position. When they have done everything for the last, since Nixon and Kissinger opened up China, everything has been for the benefit of China for the last several decades. But then they hold this up as a boogeyman to scare us. The reality is that they can add China the day after they sign this. They can add them to the TPP. According to Jeff Sessions, who's looked at the documents, they can not only change all the terms of the, you know, they're doing this in secret. They're doing it without any input from any of our elected representatives. Once they pass it, then it'll be changed forever without any further input from our elected representatives, including adding countries like China to this.
Well, you know, there is one thing, and it's that the TPA has passed, right? So the TPP has not officially passed, though it's essentially done because of the fact that Obama's going to bring it in, and you know they're going to approve it.
Right.
Because they've already approved the TPA. But the fight is not over. And Alex has a video coming up that he shot that I've seen. It's really, really inspirational. And that is, the fight is not over. I 100% agree. The fight is not over against the TPP. We can still shut it down. We can still reach out and make this huge, because I know so many people out there are so impassioned about this and they're so fired up about the TPP and they know about it. But do you know how many don't even know what it is?
Oh, yeah. And that's by design. That's why they've got the TPP, the TTIP, the TPA, the TAA. It's like the RCEP, the TISA. You know what it all spells? It spells TRAP. It's a trap. Yeah. And it's a deliberate confusion with all of this stuff. Many people were saying the first time the Senate passed the fast track, they said, that's it. TPP has passed. And they even said that they even attributed, criticized Rand Paul for voting for it. And he voted against the fast track both times. And I think the important thing is to look at that. We had Ted Cruz, who voted for fast track the first time through. The second time, he voted against it. Now, I don't.
Maybe it's really, because it had 90% disapproval, right?
Exactly.
But now we need to push it further and spread the word and spread this video that everyone's going to be watching on YouTube and spread this program and spread everything, because we need millions and millions more people to realize what the TPP is, and they need to get mad, and that's the only way we're going to win. That is the only way.
There's profound ignorance out there. It's a massive education effort. We can't do it on our own. We need to have the people who watch this take this information, give it to others, learn about it in a way that they can explain it to people, because most people don't know or care. There's still an opportunity to do something about this. Talk to them about Fast Track. Talk to them about a trans-Pacific, transatlantic partnership. Talk to them about the fact that the Republicans passed this thing and they opposed the temporary welfare benefits for people who are going to lose their jobs. That was the snag in all this. It's like, okay, if this is going to be such a great deal economically, then tell us why you're concerned about unemployment benefits. They know that unemployment benefits are going to go up. That's why they don't want to pay them. That's why they shut that part of it down. So they know this is a screw job from the economic standpoint, but it is from many other aspects. And one of those that's key is what you're talking about. The way they can hold a gun to our heads and force us to buy their products, just like they're trying to mandate vaccines. I'm going to be talking to the lady from the National Vaccine Information Center tomorrow about what's going on in California and across this country in terms of mandating vaccines. They want to mandate their products like Obamacare, like the vaccines, like the GMO products. They will use any kind of law or treaty to do that. That's the dangerous thing. That's what people need to understand.
What do you think? They're losing the battle. They know they've lost. They know over 90% want GMO labeling in the United States. They know over 90% care about the real things. They don't want to be screwed anymore by these corporations. And they know they're losing. So what are they going to do? They're going to pass the TPP. It's their only option. And it's admittance of their losing the battle. But once again, it's time for us to fight it.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you so much, Anthony Gucciardi. Let's go to a report from Rex Jones. And this is about another aspect of the way they're coming at us with world government, because it was just a week ago that the Pope threw in on the side of global warming. And of course, it has been a religion from the very beginning. And I'll tell you about that when we get back from the report. But let's go to that report from Rex Jones.
This is an engineered crisis to create artificial scarcity on the world's most valuable and simple resource, water. People like Al Gore are constantly blaming extreme weather and natural disasters on climate change when the real culprit is weather. But in all reality, climate change is quite real. Hi, I'm Rex Jones reporting for Infowars.com. With all the recent flooding in Central Texas, it's leading many people to believe that climate change is the real cause. Take a look at Barton Creek. This used to be a dry creek bed. Now look at it. It's flowing like a real river. In fact, if you take a little peek at a topography map of Texas, half of the state is green and the other half is brown. Here in Austin, Texas, where the Texas Hill Country begins and the flatland ends, is the known boundary between wet and dry areas of Texas. In fact, we had so much rain here over Memorial Day weekend, my good friend Stevie Ray Vaughan was almost underwater. The general weather in the state of Texas can vary from snowstorms to a desert heat, but generally our climate stays the same. People like Al Gore are constantly blaming extreme weather and natural disasters on climate change when the real culprit is weather. But in all reality, climate change is quite real. Here's an excerpt by well-known climatologist Tim Ball as he details the effects of real climate change on the world today.
My life has spanned four climate changes. I was in the pre-war warming up to 1940, and then I was in the cooling that occurred from 1940 to about 1980. And then I was in the warming from 80 to 98. Now we're into another cooling trend. And hopefully I'll live to at least one more climate change. When I started out, it was not a contentious issue at all. Now it's become one of the most contentious in the world because it's been exploited for political purposes. Just as we talked about with Einstein, if you were to show that there was something going faster than the speed of light, would put that whole theory in jeopardy. With the anthropogenic global warming theory, the idea that a CO2 increase will cause a temperature increase is now clearly shown to be wrong. In fact, I challenge anybody to show me a record of any duration, of any time period in the history of the Earth in which CO2 precedes a temperature increase. In fact, in every case, it's the opposite. Temperature increases before CO2. And it will take, ironically, a cooling of the Earth, as is now occurring, to make people start to question. And so eventually, the people will start to understand how bad the science is, how wrong the original theory was, and the whole thing will collapse.
Most of the crazy weather we've been having is largely blamed by meteorologists on the pattern of weather known as El Nino, which is a warm patch in the Pacific Ocean, which leads to more rain in general in the United States of America. As you can see, we're getting the full force of El Nino this year, and with meteorologists saying that there's a 95% chance that it will continue on to this fall, we haven't seen the last of this rainy weather. Barton Creek feeds into Lady Bird Lake, also known as the Colorado River, behind me. And even though we have many dams in place, massive rainfall can still cause heavy flooding. People like Al Gore and the Pope are claiming yet again that climate change is caused by human activity. How about we have a real scientist talk about the issues? Here's weather forecaster Piers Corbin on what is the real biggest effector of climate change.
The origin of our solar weather technique of long-range forecasting came originally from study of sunspots and a desire to predict those. And then I realized it was actually much more interesting to use the sun to predict the weather.
What they found was an incredibly close correlation between what the sun was doing and changes in temperature on Earth. To the Harvard astrophysicists and many other scientists, the conclusion is inescapable.
The sun is driving climate change. CO2 is irrelevant.
Another place climate change preachers are flocking to spread their fear porn would be California with its three-year drought. This doesn't seem that big compared to 200 and 400 and even 1,000-year droughts that have happened in California's past. The real problem with California is that it hasn't provided adequate enough reservoirs to supply water to the tens of millions of people that live there today. This is an engineered crisis to create artificial scarcity on the world's most valuable and simple resource, water. But the place where climate change preachers can do real damage is in trade agreements such as the TPP. The TPP is going to put no environmental restrictions whatsoever on third world developing countries, allowing them to develop freely. This doesn't sound like such a bad thing, but well-developed countries will be shackled to the ideals of environmentalism and be forced to have very strict, almost insane environmental regulations. So when people start preaching to you about Bill Nye, Al Gore, and the Pope telling us that climate change is all our fault, just tell them that they're complaining about the weather. I'm Rex Jones, reporting for InfoWars.com.
It's a great report from Rex Jones. And of course, as you heard that scientist talking about this, the determining factor is the sun. I think it's very interesting when we look at this pronouncement that came out last week from the Pope. Of course, the guy that was it was ghostwritten. We don't know exactly who wrote it for him. But the guy that he's lifting up, pushing forward, is a guy named Schellenhuber from Germany. And he has made some horrifying pronouncements, not only about getting rid of 6 billion people on the Earth, thinking that we can only carry about a billion or so, but he's also made some horrific statements about world government. And, of course, that was what the Pope was pushing. The Pope actually said, you know, we're seeing that economic power and multinational corporations, they're starting to have the real power. So in order to control them, because he believes it's markets and freedom are the problem. And of course, that has nothing to do with multinational corporations. He thinks somehow that a world government is going to control the multinational corporations. It isn't going to happen. The multinational corporations are the world government. We need to wake up to what's going on. We'll talk about this science a little bit more when we come back. And Leanne McAdoo is going to be joining us with a special report from the street. What do people think about these monuments? Are they going to take down Thomas Jefferson next? And in that last segment, we heard a report from Rex Jones. One of the people that he had in the report was talking about how the dominant factor on climate is the sun. Wow. Think about that. Don't you think that maybe has a little bit more effect than what you or I are doing with our cars? Listen, as we look at this pronouncement from the Pope last week, we need to remember that the first time he appointed somebody to the Pontifical Academy of Sciences, the first pope did that, that was Galileo. And Galileo put forward Copernicus's idea of a universe that was not centered around the Earth. Now, the Pope pushed back on that because they had a preset determination that man was the center of the universe. No, actually, the sun is the center of the solar system. We revolve around that solar system. Now we see someone being put in the Academy of Sciences, the Pontifical Academy of Sciences, by the Pope, this John Schellenhuber. He believes that man is the center of climate change. Again, the same type of mistake, not supported by scientific information. It's reported, supported by a lot of scientists who make their living out of selling climate fear. We had the head of the IPCC from the UN, the International Panel on Climate Change, just stepped down because he was involved in a sex scandal. But as he stepped down, he said, climate change is my religion. It is my dharma. They have argued this not from data. They have made this argument from authority. Listen to us. The majority of scientists say this. Well, you know what? Back at the time they had the first Pontifical Academy of Sciences, the majority of scientists said that the Earth was the center of the universe. Science is not determined by majority opinion. It's determined by facts. One of the things that bothers me, and of course this applies to what we're seeing with the secret trade agreements, the secret laws are being created by the FISA court. Everything is a secret. And of course the data that these people have collected is a secret. We get to see what their conclusions are. We get to see what their pronouncements are. That's what ClimateGate was all about. People said, I've seen what your conclusions say, and you're projecting some stuff out here. We have no way of verifying your models. These are new models. You're projecting things that are out 50 years from now, 100 years from now, several centuries from now. We have no way to verify that. It's not like we can go and look at the weather forecasting models. And oh, by the way, John Schellenhuber, the Pope's science advisor, says we're investing too much in things like improving weather forecasts. No, those are real models. That's real science. They can go out and say, is it going to rain tomorrow? Well, they look at their models to see if that's going to be true, and they can actually verify that against real data. When it comes to climate change, on these large time scales, we have to just trust their authority. See, it's always been a religious issue. They even call people who don't blindly trust their authority, their group speak, they call us deniers. No, we're skeptics. We want to see the data. When we've asked to see the data because their models have failed, they've made some short-term pronouncements. Those short-term pronouncements have not come true. Even though we've seen an increase in CO2, we've not seen a concurrent rise in the temperature that their models predicted. We haven't seen a rise. We haven't seen a rise in humidity that they predicted would happen. A lot of these things are not happening. Of course, they tout their models. This guy, Schellenhuber, he's got his institute, the PIK Institute in Germany. He's talking about their new model. Their new model is Climber 3. It's better than Climber 2 or Climber 1. Hey, why does he have a Climber 3? It's because Climber 1 and Climber 2 didn't give him the information. We asked for the information. We couldn't get it. That's why we had ClimateGate. That's why we found out that there were secret emails saying we have to hide the decline. The models are not working. But they keep it secret. Stay with us. We're going to be right back. Leanne McAdoo is going to talk to us about what she found out on the street yesterday when she talked to people about the Confederate flag. Is it a false flag? Is it a red herring? Are they going to come after Thomas Jefferson? In the next segment, we're going to be talking to Leanne McAdoo as far as the man on the street that she did here in Austin, talking to people about the Confederate flag controversy. There are some real substantive issues about that. We're going to talk about that as well as look at the video. In this segment, I wanted to continue talking about this climate change issue because, as I said before, to put man at the center of climate change and ignore the sun is as foolish as putting the Earth at the center of the solar system and saying that everything revolves around us. But it is even more dangerous than that because not only is it bad science, not only are we not allowed to look at the data, and remember, with ClimateGate, what happened was they went to East Anglia University in the UK. They said, we want to see your data because you've done these studies. You've drawn these conclusions. We're talking about doing massive changes to our society. And we need to validate your data to make sure that you did this correctly. And, well, you can't see our data. This went on for a very long time. Finally, somebody leaked 1,000 emails to a server in Russia. That was ClimateGate. We saw that they were talking about things like, let's hide the decline. The models aren't working, so forth and so on. That went on for quite some time. It looked like there was going to be some changes made. But, of course, this is really about politics and religion more than it is about science. So nothing happened. Then again, we had a second climate gate. This time, 5,000 emails were leaked on that Russian server from East Anglia. We saw that there were also emails involving American climate, let's say professionals, experts, okay? Like Michael Mann of the University of Virginia. Again, they would not let us see their emails. I was part of a group that tried to get those emails revealed. Ken Cuccinelli in Virginia, the attorney general, sued to get those emails. They kept those emails back saying, these are private emails. Well, at the time, these were all emails that were on the server of the University of Virginia when he was working there. These were things that were done on the university computer while he was being paid by the university, doing work for the university. So that should have been seen by the public. It shouldn't have been private. Is he really on the government's payroll? Is he doing private work while he's there? That's what we need to know. Nevertheless, he said, well, this is also proprietary data. It's like, no, your research has been published. It is being used for public policy. We need to validate your data. They won't show it to us. That tells you something stinks, just like something stinks with the secret trade agreements that we're seeing. But there's another aspect of this that we really haven't talked about, and that is Schellenhuber's idea of a world government. Of course, he's part of the Earth League. The person at the center of the Earth League is Prince Charles, but he's one of the scientists putting this out. They have put out an Earth statement. One of the things that they want, of course, is world government. And here's how this would break down. They're going to have an Earth constitution. They're going to have a global council. They want a planetary court, a transnational. We keep seeing that word come up all the time. It's in our secret trade agreements. It's in all these different things. Transnational. Everything needs to move to a world government. That's what the Pope is pushing, is a transnational planetary court that is a legal body open to appeals from everyone, especially with respect to violations of the Earth Constitution. So when you look at these three aspects, you see that what he's putting out here is a legal document. He's putting out a elected body, an Earth Council, as well as a court to make people do this. These are all the different aspects of a world government. That's what we're seeing with these trade agreements that are coming up. And again, this next hour, we're going to have Alex Jones explaining to us that we haven't lost the entire battle yet. We can still fight the Trans-Pacific, the Transatlantic agreements that are coming on. The fast track is there. It's accelerating it. It's going to make it very difficult to stop it, but we can stop it. They're coming at us from multiple directions for world government, whether it's for climate change or whether they call it trade, free trade. It's not free. There's nothing at all free about it. Whatever you look at, they're coming at us from multiple directions, and we have to fight back on this. We're in a fight for our life. We're in a fight for our freedom and our independence. Stay with us. We're going to be talking to Leanne McAdoo. Joining me in the studio is Leanne McAdoo. We're going to talk about her man on the street yesterday. I guess lady on the street. We'll talk about that. Before we do, I want to let you know about Nason Iodine. You know, we've been talking about all the different mandates that are coming at us, the secret laws, the secret groups, the push towards world government. We've been talking about what's going on in Greece, how they are staring at an economic collapse. You know, when you go bankrupt and you're very wealthy, or when you go bankrupt as a country, it happens slowly, then suddenly. We don't know when economic collapse is going to happen. You need to prepare yourself now. You need to prepare for your health. Try to make yourself as healthy as you can. You need to store the things that you're going to need now as well. You know, we got a couple of reviews that were comments that came in, and this is on Nascent Iodine X2. Anthony Gucciardi gave these to me. It's pretty good comments. So we've got feedback that has been very positive on this from a lot of different people. Here's just two of them. Hornet in Ann Arbor, Michigan said, this is the fourth Nascent Iodine this month. Stocking up. My wife has lost 37 pounds using this. Another one from Mel in Florida said, I use the product daily as I just feel better. When I miss a day or a few days, I feel terrible. Therefore, high-quality products that will keep you healthy. You know, it's something that I use because I know that in my diet, I don't get enough iodine. They've cut down on the supplementation of it, adding it as they used to a lot of foods. They don't do that now. And so we need to take an active role in our own health in preparing for our future. A great way to do that is to stock up on X2 Nascent Iodine at InfoWarsLife.com right now. Now, joining us is Leanne McAdoo. Now, Leanne, you went out yesterday and you talked to people about their attitudes towards, of course, we had the statue of Jefferson Davis that was defaced here in Austin at the University of Texas campus, right?
Correct, yeah.
And so you went out and talked to some people about that, but tried to extend that out a little bit more broadly, because right. It's about more than just a few symbols and what people think they understand or think they know about those symbols. Tell us a little bit about that.
Right. Really just wanting to kind of see if people would be willing to take down the statues of George Washington and Thomas Jefferson, slave owners.
Yeah.
And that's all it was kind of like the buzzword there, racist slave owners. And people really were, they were willing to do that. So
well, they are, yeah.
That's kind of what I've learned two things yesterday. One, that it's completely false, you know, under this administration that racism is at an all-time high. And that there's this race war going on, because it's not true. You go out there and so many people, so many young people, older people that I talked to, they all engaged me in conversation, but they were willing to take down sort of symbols of racism, right?
Mm-hmm.
What's also at an all-time high under this administration is totalitarianism and this teaching that anything that bothers you or anything that's bad, you know, needs to be erased and wiped
out.
That's what
I'm concerned
about. Like, acceptance. But it's non-acceptance. Mm-hmm. So they're kind of putting it across as this, we're all open and accepting and liberal, but it's actually... Yeah.
That's the whole thing about political correctness and multiculturalism. You know, it has their gods that are fiercely worshipped, and you better not blaspheme them. And it really is about symbolism over substance. Look, right. Thomas Jefferson had slaves, okay? He was bothered by it. He put in a massive section about slavery in the Declaration of Independence. They took it out at the time because they wanted to... focus it on other issues. They thought that was too controversial. It was going to cause division in the South.
Mm-hmm.
He and others said, we have a tiger by the tail. They wanted to get out of it. They weren't sure how to get out of it.
Right.
And so it was something that basically had been carried forward. They were looking for ways to get out of it. Many people were. But regardless of what your opinion of Thomas Jefferson is, this is fundamentally, when I say it's about symbols over substance, this is fundamentally about attacking the principles.
Right.
It's about deconstructing the principles on which this country was founded.
Right.
And that's why they're going to go after Jefferson.
And it's all about demonizing the founding fathers and demonizing anyone who would dare put forth this idea of freedom.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
free men, all created equal.
That's right. Yeah. Instead of saying, well, wait a minute, when you wrote that was only... the only people that were getting freedom were some white people and black people were left out of that. Instead of saying that, they need to stand up and say, look, this is for all men. Let's make that literal. Let's say all men. Let's name it and claim it or whatever. Let's say that applies to black people, applies to women, it applies to everybody. Other countries have done this.
Right.
Other countries looked at this. It is the best. The Declaration of Independence is the best statement of the rights of man that has been produced by anybody so far.
Right.
Calling and pointing out that they don't come from a government. That governments are created to establish those rights. And when the government destroys those rights, it is not only your right, but your duty to abolish that government and replace it with one that will protect your rights. And so it's a great statement of our rights and coming from our creator and what our position is as human beings. And so we need to all claim this rather than trying to let them divide and conquer us and to push this away.
Right. And that's all it is. It's divide and conquer. And it's all about black and white and racist this and slave, when it was a completely different time. And it's not as if slavery was only in America.
Yes,
you know,
absolutely.
It's been like this forever, many cultures,
and it continues
many
on
colors.
With Walmart and many other corporations.
Exactly.
So let's take a quick
slave
look
labor.
At that. Yeah, so let's take a look at that report before we run out of time.
Hey, can I get you to sign this petition to get the president to take down these racist statues of George Washington and Thomas Jefferson?
Racist statues? What do you mean?
Yeah, I mean, I'm white, but this kind of helps me like alleviate some of the guilt of like slavery and all that.
Okay, so. Might as well.
Yeah, you know, it's all history, but they all had slaves. Even George Washington up there that everyone's like idolizes because he's just a founding father, but he had slaves. I mean, do you feel like guilty at all for slavery? I mean, does that offend you when the statues are just like looking down on you all the time and you're like, okay, we get it, you're racist?
And I understand that, but it's also part of our history, and so I have to support it.
It's kind of a really bad part of our history we need to erase.
But we learn from our history. History hates itself if we're not careful. So, and I value your beliefs. I really do.
Probably then the rest of the racist guys, is, I mean, yeah, the founding father, but they had slaves.
I do think it is part of history.
Yeah, but it's almost like if we can control the way people view history, then we can control the future going forward. And like we have the power in the present to control the past.
Yeah, I agree.
I mean, the way I see it, because it's so bad, it's like as if you're having like a statue of maybe Hitler or someone like that.
Exactly. So. Let's put up a statue of Hitler up there. There's a huge socialist movement on UT campus. So trying to kind of shift the country in that direction.
Yeah. What do you think about our president right now? You think he's good for the country?
I mean, I think he's doing a great job.
Okay. See, that's where we differ. Because he's actually...
So you're not going to vote for Hillary? He thinks President Obama's worse than the racist founding fathers?
He absolutely is.
Wow.
He absolutely is.
Come on. White people can sort of suck, and we sure don't need any more statues of them. Would you like to alleviate some white guilt? He symbolizes white supremacy, slavery. I mean, really, all our founding fathers were racist because they had slaves.
Mm-hmm.
People have this argument about, you know, it's like the First Amendment and stuff. You know, I think they take that too far.
They do.
It's kind of about controlling history at this point so we can rewrite it, change, you know, transform. Be a little bit more aggressive with progressiveness.
I would never even have thought of that.
You never would have. Well, you know why? Because it's white privilege.
Yeah.
Ooh, prove you're not racist, Red. That guy up there has got to go. We got General Robert E. Lee and then some other white guy nobody even knows who he is in his little Confederate outfit or whatever. It's just racism, and we want it taken down before the start of the fall semester.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'll sign it.
Will you sign my petition to get the president of UT to take down the racist statues?
Yeah.
Just like the founding fathers, they're all
so
racist.
So is Thomas Jefferson and George Washington and the founders of our country.
I know, and they all have statues.
I mean, they founded America.
If we can control the past, we can control the future. What do you think they symbolize? I've been hearing a lot of different reactions to that. It's like history and...
Treason?
What?
Treason?
Treason?
Yeah.
Oh, really? And so, I mean, that's exactly... Can you imagine someone trying to secede or whatever today under President Obama? I mean, that just, like, sends a bad message.
Yeah.
So a lot of people are thinking this is like, you know, it's our history and we got to keep it here, but...
Again, for those who joining us on the radio, this is a petition that Leanne McAdoo took down to the University of Texas. Getting people to sign it to take down all Confederate symbols.
Forever.
Right. Anything that we deem racist and offensive at this point.
Yeah, let's...
No matter what it was about then or what it symbolized or if they helped to found this country, you know, this great country that everyone is rushing to move to.
Yeah.
You know?
So there was one lady there who took exception to what you were saying, and, mm-hmm. and you were kind of playing devil's advocate there, trying to encourage people to feel their white privilege and sign that. But tell us a little bit about what she said.
Well, you know, she just pointed out that it's not a great part of our history necessarily, but we need to be aware of our history because if not, we're doomed to repeat it.
Yes.
And that's kind of the big thing that always bugs me about the social faux pas to ever bring up Hitler and the Nazis. And nobody will, you know, that's like, oh, quiet about that. But we need to understand that it wasn't just one bad dictator that did that.
Mm-hmm.
He was able to propagandize and socially control an entire country.
Mm-hmm.
To
yeah, absolutely.
Help him commit democide.
Exactly. And they're not interested in just taking away the Confederate battle flag as a symbol. They're interested in going to the root of the issue because most of the presidents up until the Civil War, as we call it, most of the presidents were from Virginia. I think there's five of them from Virginia. After that, the power center really kind of moved to Ohio. Mm-hmm. And so there was a massive change. And anybody who knows history knows that there was a massive consolidation. Prior to the Civil War, everybody talked about the United States are. It was a group of sovereign states that had created a central government with very specific delegated powers. After Lincoln's War, it became an empire of consolidation. We're going to talk a little bit about that. We're going to talk a little bit about the Ku Klux Klans. Stay with us. We'll be right back. studio with Leanne McAdoo. We just looked at the reaction that people had on the street as Leanne went out kind of playing a devil's advocate because there had been defacement of the Confederate monument there. Let's see, it's Jefferson Davis, wasn't it? Okay. There was a defacement there, so she took a petition out to get people's attitude about that. Of course, we see an article on Infowars.com how the Amazon staff are now answering questions as to why they're taking down all Confederate flags, the battle flag of Northern Virginia. Why did you take it down? Well, they say we were told that this is a federal law. Now, that could just be an ignorant employee as part of this. Actually, the person who was talking to them got it in a chat, a text chat, and actually took a screenshot of that. That could just be one employee doesn't know what's going on, but other people were told that as well. So that's interesting. That's an article from Paul Joseph Watson. And then, of course, we have Apple's movements on this too, don't we, Leanne?
Right. We're seeing it all over eBay, Walmart. Now Apple has removed all American Civil War games from the App Store because of the Confederate flag. So you can play these games or you reenact the Civil War, but now no more because of the flag that flies there. But you can still go and play games where it simulates rape and beatings and carjackings. And I mean, that's completely fine.
And you can get Nazi memorabilia as well.
Exactly.
You know, it's interesting. If you go to Google, if you type in KKK 1920s, take a look at the pictures there. Look at images. What you're going to see from the Ku Klux Klowns is you're going to see them carrying American flags everywhere. Okay, they're waving American flags. You got giant American flags that are being held by 100 people going down Pennsylvania Avenue and the Capitol. You're going to also see crosses. Now, those are symbols that they co-opted. Certainly, the American flag and certainly the cross do not align with their principles. You can also see that if you go to the KKK 1960s. You'll see the same thing. It's the American flag. One guy pointed out in a video we got up on Infowars.com, he said, you know, the Confederate battle flag started being used by the Ku Klux Klan once they were infiltrated by the FBI. You know, we need to understand what this stuff is really and truly about. Mm-hmm. Malcolm X, Leanne, and the Black Panthers became truly dangerous to the power structure once they reached out and started embracing people of every race. Once they were all just about being black, they left them alone, pretty much. They followed them. They watched them closely. But as Larry Pinkney has talked about it, you know, in the old days of the Black Panthers, before the new Black Panthers, once they were just a group that involved just black people, when Malcolm X was just about black people, they left them alone. When they started reaching out to other groups, then they became dangerous. And that's when we become dangerous to the system, is when we start standing together, treating each other as humans, standing up on the basic principles of the Declaration of Independence that Jefferson wrote. And they don't want that to happen. This is a process of deconstruction. You know, one of the things that we never hear talked about in Civil War history is Reconstruction. It wasn't Reconstruction. It was deconstruction, just like the Patriot Act is not patriotic. They always use these lies to put this stuff through. And that type of approach began as we moved into the American Empire. But what they're trying to do now is they're trying to deconstruct the past. As we mentioned with the Orwell quote, you know, those who control the past control the future. The only effective check against centralization of power, against an abusive government that takes your rights instead of protecting them, is ultimately to use your right, your duty, to separate from that government. And we have people who are even talking about doing that now out west in Oregon and California. They've grown apart culturally, politically. They want the right of independence and self-government. There's not anything about slavery involved in that unless you can say these people are being treated as slaves by the federal government, just like that situation with the raisin company where they go in and say, give us 30% of your raisins.
Right.
Just give it to me. I mean, that's worse than serfs.
Right.
Serfs only had to pay 10%.
And that's exactly what this is about. People will say, oh, well, this is a victory for the race, you know, racism. It's not. This is a longer agenda of destroying America's icons.
Yes. Yes,
taking away everything we have.
You know, clearly when we look at how do we fight back against things like out of control police brutality? Now, remember that video that we had just a couple of weeks ago where they had a white guy legally carrying a long rifle strapped over his shoulder openly, okay? And he was confronted by a cop. I think if he would have probably something else would have happened if there had been somebody filming it. But when they did the same experiment with a black guy, the cop jumps out of the car, draws the gun on him, and starts screaming frantically, get down on the ground, get down on the ground, and telling the pregnant woman who's taking pictures there, you get down on the ground, face down, I can't get face down, I'm pregnant. There is a difference. There is a difference in the way black people are treated in the war on drugs, the way they are incarcerated, the incarceration rates. But the way to solve this is not to separate out into a smaller minority, but to join with the larger group and united oppose all of this. We're not any of us going to get our freedom unless we come together, because they're holding the cards right now.
Right.
They rammed through these trade agreements, and we're going to talk about that in the next segment. Alex has got a special report about how the TPP has not passed yet. The fast track has. We can still stop it. It's going to be harder now, but we can still stop it. We're going to be talking about that. We've also got a special call to action, how you can join in the info war and help to fight back against that. Thank you so much, Leanne McAdoo.
Alex Jones here with an exciting announcement. Do you have what it takes to join the info war? Would you like to work here in Austin, Texas, inside the InfoWars News Center that now reaches more than 18 million people across the globe every week? We need InfoWarriors. We need talented people who love the truth, who love freedom, and who love humanity to join our operation. We're going to be taking applications at the email jobs@InfoWars.com and online at InfoWars.com at InfoWars.com/jobs. We're going to be hiring radio crew. We're going to be hiring writers. We're going to be hiring investigative journalists. We're going to be going out there directly to you, the patriots who love freedom all over this country, who want to work inside our operation. Now, most of the hires will be inside InfoWars. Some can work remotely as writers. We're going to be hiring folks directly on, but we're also going to be giving people a chance at paid internships to come in for a week, a month, or longer to see if you fit in to this operation. We're ready to go to the next level. Find out the details at InfoWars.com/jobs or email us your resume, your video reel, your background, what you stand for, and why you want to join the InfoWars crew. So whether you're an established journalist or whether you're just a novice video editor, what matters is that you take action, that you stand for freedom, and that you want to work hard in defense of human liberties. We're looking for journalists. We're looking for writers. We're looking for investigative reporters. We're looking for folks to help promote freedom via our social media platforms, graphic designers, paid internships. And if folks have got a good resume and a good background, we'll also be hiring some people directly on at InfoWars.com as we prepare to take the fight to the next level against the New World Order. In 20 years, InfoWars has been exponentially growing. We're about to hopefully take a huge leap forward when it comes to upping the amount of news we can cover, the amount of stories we can break, because world government is being rolled out in everybody's face right now. People are waking up. This is the time to have a maximum effort to reach out to humanity. And this is your chance to be part of the InfoWars.com news operations. So throw your hat in the ring. If you think you've got what it takes, you're ready to take action. And I hope to be working side by side with you right here at the InfoWars.com news centers in Austin, Texas. So send those video reels, send those graphic designs, send your work to us so we can see if you've got what it takes to be part of this operation.
Absolutely, folks. And this is David Knight here in the studio. Of course, what Alex is saying there is absolutely true. I've seen it firsthand. He is 100% into this, trying to stop the type of thing that we just saw yesterday with the fast track of these trade agreements. The only way we're going to stop that is if we can get the information out. We got a report coming up from Alex in just a few minutes where he's going to talk about what we need to do at this point in terms of educating people. But in order to do that, we have to grow the operation. Now, one of the ways we're going to pay for the people that we're going to add is, of course, we could take donations. We've done that in the past. But primarily, Alex likes to fund the operation by offering you products that are going to help you in a win-win situation. Of course, the newest product we got is Liver Shield and Liver Shield Advanced Cleanse, which is a combination of Liver Shield and Oxy Powder in a combination there. It's very important that you get yourself in good condition, that you maintain optimum health, because you don't know what's coming down the pike. The liver is responsible for over 500 separate functions in the body, including its role as your primary filter of toxins. So how do you clean that filter? Well, one way you can do that very effectively is with Liver Shield. I'm getting ready to start mine this weekend. Alex has talked about this, and the results are real, absolutely real. I'm not going to go into the details of it, but this is something that can be very beneficial. You do need to clean the filter in your body, and of course, it's got 500 different functions you need to keep yourself healthy with a healthy liver. Again, InfoWarsLife.com, that's Liver Shield, introductory offer, as well as Liver Shield Advanced Cleanse. That's Liver Shield and Oxy Powder. Now, continuing with what we were talking about in the last segment with Leanne, we've got a video that I want to run by Alfonso Rachel with Zonation. And it's on the Democratic Party's long history of racism.
Okay, let's pick up where we left off on the last Zonation. Have you ever read the original Democrat Party platform? The original included language to protect their so-called right to force people into slavery. But Republicans are the racist because the original Republican Party platform was to abolish slavery? And when liberals are reminded of this, they always say the same thing. Yeah, well, you know what, Zoe? That was a long time ago, and you need to get over it. Really? Okay, well, you know what? Slavery itself was a long time ago. Why don't y'all get over that? Oh, but that's how you liberals are. You're always able to use something as an excuse, like slavery. But that's okay. That's okay. Let's say you can actually use slavery as an excuse. To the Afrocentric, loyal Democrat voting liberals who insist and swear up and down that the black community is still profoundly affected by slavery, even though it happened a long time ago, why don't you still hold the Democrats responsible for trying to force institutionalized slavery? Yeah, you kind of got a funny taste in your mouth right about now, don't you? Yeah, I think it's the taste of them boots you loyal Democrats, Afrocentric liberals always accuse us conservatives of licking. I'm just guessing, because unlike you, as a conservative, I really don't know what these boots taste like. Y'all have been sucking boots so long that you're oblivious to the flavor. Kind of like chewing a piece of gum long after the flavor's gone. And then you accuse black conservatives of being the bootlickers. And we can be sure that these accusations will continue as liberals accuse me of being a whore and being paid to say these things the GOP writes for me, even though none have yet to prove that anyone writes my scripts but me. White people write Obama scripts all the time, though, and y'all don't seem too mad about him saying all the things that those white liberals want him to say. So anyway, slavery happened long ago. But you still want to use that as an excuse. Well, then be consistent. You should still hold the Democrats responsible for the KKK, Jim Crow, Dred Scott, revocation of civil rights, denial of 40 acres and a mule, segregation, anti-miscegenation, and eugenics. You know that was the Democrat Party. That's why you liberals try to use some lame excuse that the party switched sides. Which is a lie anyway. And even that in itself is an admission because the Democrats had to be the racist party to begin with to be supposedly switched anyway. The Democrat agenda is still the same, to make us subjects of the state. But now they do this under the sugar-coated guise of fairness. And as a buddy of mine, Joe Dan, reminds us, Democrats talk more about fairness than freedom.
That's a great video. And again, that is a video by Alfonso Rachel with Zonation. You can see that at InfoWars.com. We got the full video up there. You know, it's interesting. We don't want to get so slavishly controlled by any one party. And that's what he's talking about in that video at the very beginning. People say, well, you know, slavery, we want to talk about that. But let's not talk about the Democrat Party's role in oppression as well through Jim Crow and these other issues. Look, we don't need to be slavishly devoted to any party. We don't need to be slavishly devoted to the GOP either. We don't need to be slavishly devoted to Lincoln. Look, drafting people is a form of slavery. That first happened under Abraham Lincoln. Giving us a fiat currency, taking away the gold behind it. That happened under Lincoln. That's a form of slavery as well. Think about the NDAA, indefinite detention without trial. Yeah, that's pretty outrageous, isn't it? Guess when that first happened? Under Lincoln. Yeah, he took away habeas corpus. He locked up one-third of the Maryland legislature, as well as a congressman, as well as a guy who was running for governor. Many different places, but especially in Maryland. He came down with a hammer because he did not want to have the Maryland legislature vote for secession. So to make that happen, he just locked them up. No trial for you. You don't get a lawyer, as Lindsey Graham said. Well, that's what Lincoln said. So we don't need to be slavishly devoted to anybody's deconstruction of history, anybody's hagiography about Lincoln or the GOP. We need to think for ourselves. If you want to think for yourself, if you want to understand what's going on, go back and read the books of the people who fought the war. They didn't call each other white supremacists. They didn't call each other racist. You know, quite frankly, everybody was a white supremacist racist at that time, pretty much, especially Lincoln. Look at the Lincoln-Douglas debates. What they called each other, what they called the South, was secesh. Even more so than rebel. They were concerned because of secession. But secession is our fundamental, that is the last straw, but that is a straw that we keep, or I should say an arrow that we keep in our quiver. That is what the Declaration of Independence was. It was about secession. It was a declaration of war. We don't want to see it happen, but that is the nuclear option. That needs to remain on the table. And it doesn't have to happen violently. You had Norway and Sweden seceded, went their separate ways peacefully. So it doesn't have to be a war. We can have self-governance and independence. Let's go to this report from Alex Jones talking about how we fight against the TPP, because it hasn't passed yet.
Ladies and gentlemen, this message is not just to Americans. It's to people around the world who want their children to grow up free and not slaves. The entire history of civilization for 6,000 years has been between the people who produce the culture and tiny elites that organize themselves into criminal gangs to suppress the people. We fought a revolution and won it from an empire that never been defeated in 1776. Over 150 years later, the very same British round table groups founded the Council on Foreign Relations in New York City with the stated goal of bringing the United States into a new British empire. Now, to be clear, the British don't run this today, but that model, that system, the corporations and combines, the robber barons that grew out of it, are establishing a planetary government. You notice the Pope's calling for world government and carbon taxes right now. You notice that's being suddenly admitted to all over the news after decades of denial. We've now hit the point of it emerging. The Trans-Pacific Partnership passed yesterday. Now, there's still a chance to beat it, but the fact that Congress would give the president dictatorial power to agree to whatever these foreign secretive bodies have set up is truly unprecedented. And here's the bad news. Trade Promotion Authority, once it's been handed to a president before briefly, the Senate and the House have never voted it down. And it allows a rubber stamp in the next 60 days to sign on to whatever treaty that will remain secret until it's passed is. Notice that despite the fact TPP was passed yesterday, we still can't see it. But all the Republican and Democratic senators that are for it, the traitors, true traitors, kept saying you can read it after we pass it. But they mean after we signed on to the treaty. And the word is most of it won't even be released then. The three sections we've seen are draconian. Anthony Gucciardi, David Knight, and the rest of our crew have been breaking that down today here on the radio. This is one of the most devastating blows against our freedom ever, and it shows that we have a Congress that is bought and paid for. I salute the Democrats, who are the largest group against it. They're insane on many fronts, but handing the president total dictatorial power to a secret treaty a lot of them got was a fraud. And their constituents know what a screw job NAFTA and GATT was entering us into this system to begin with. The Tea Party fought it as well. How about we come together and save this country and not let them divide and conquer us with these distractions about rebel flags? My God, people, we're not being conquered by the Confederacy. We're being conquered by the globalists, and they're admitting the whole thing. Continue the fight. It's uphill at this point. But here's the good news. Even if they're able to ratify this and ram it through, finally, the secret takeover, even if they're able to do that, now they have to implement it over the years. England never even knew they were brought into the EU secretly in the late 80s, early 90s, in two different phases of the Maastricht Treaty. Now they know about it and are moving to pull out. So the beginning of the end of world government is when they try to actually set it up and don't rule from the shadows and start installing their technocrats in power everywhere. Then people go, wait a minute, the conspiracy theorists for 30, 40 years fighting this, they were right. We weren't conspiracy theorists. We went and read the Treaty of Rome, the Maastricht Treaty. We interviewed the top experts, the members of Parliament. I've traveled to England, traveled to Europe. I mean, Ron Paul's warned. Now we've got Senator Sessions on the floor a few days ago saying this is world government. They're merging the North American Union, the Asian Union, and the EU together. And all of it's done by stealth. It's not trade. It's a takeover. They want to fool Democrats by saying, ooh, Obama had a victory. Ooh, you had a victory. Obama's legacy. This isn't about Obama. He's a puppet. The trendy to help shove it through. And Democrats aren't buying it. That's the good news. Republicans, look at those blue bloods like Boehner and others. They are the scum of the earth. I mean, this is true treason. America has already been taken over by the private Federal Reserve. But now they're transferring what was left of the power to their secretive boards. All right, that's it for this update. I'll be filing other updates at InfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. If we the people stand up and take action, we're unstoppable. You, the viewers, the listeners, have the power. You can change this. We've got to change the debate over from the tranny operations and the rebel flag distractions and from gay marriage and stuff like this to the big issue that we're being conquered by globalists that are devastatingly cold-blooded, and any country they get a hold of, they loot. They will debase us. They will bring us down like Greece and others. That's how they control us, by making us poor. They admit it. This is their philosophy. We've watched them do this in countless countries. We got the IMF and World Bank documents in 2002 where they admitted the whole plan and said the West was next. I've had Greg Palestine, BBC reporter, investigative journalist, and he's interviewed one of the founders of the euro who admitted it was designed to implode nation states, suck them dry. This is economic conquest. This will hurt you and your family. If you thought NAFTA and GATT cut your wages and screwed the country up, that was just the beginning. The people are now waking up. The battle is just starting. And they barely were able to ram this through. So they're not invincible. They want you to think all is lost. You can't defeat them. That's a fraud. What they're doing is so over the top that they either win because they're so bold or they fail because they're so bold. Will their confidence game go on forever? Will the United States of America and the UK, England, Germany, all these great nations, sovereign nations that fought huge wars with each other, now just give in to a bunch of scum bankers who create a bunch of counterfeit derivatives? This is the world being conquered by people worse than Bernie Madoff, worse than Ken Lay. It was Ken Lay with carbon taxes. I mean, this is a group of scum. Are we really ruled by the hypocrite Al Gore? Are we really ruled by frauds like Michael Moore with his six bodyguards with guns, but you can't have them? Are we really going to be under this new royalty and submit to their tyranny? The decision is up to you. But the battle against TPP now goes into the next phase. It's uphill. But within that fight, we will expose it even more. And then suddenly, it'll be downhill. The more we fight, the stronger we get. It's like muscles. It's a long struggle. History shows that.
As you were hearing in that last segment, Alex Jones was saying, we're not done yet. Of course, the TPP has not passed. We need to understand that. That's another part of their tactic, is to think, make you think that it's already over, to make you think that you've lost. They haven't had the vote. They voted and passed fast track, and now they're going to try to run down. We've got at least, there were two treaties that we know they've been working on for a very long time, the transatlantic, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, joining us to Asia, joining us to Europe, just as we've seen with the Trilateral Commission's plan for a world government, moving from economic unity to political unity. Nevertheless, there are other treaties that are going coming down the road, but we can fight these one at a time. And as Alex pointed out, even if they pass these, we can still reverse them. There are people in Europe now who are pushing to get out of the EU. So it's not over. As he pointed out, once people understand that we weren't spouting out some wild conspiracy theories, we were telling you what their conspiracy plans were and have been for a very long time. When we look at this Supreme Court decision today, again, there was another Supreme Court decision on Obamacare. When we look at Obamacare and we look at Obama trade, they have something in common, and it's not Obama. It is holding a gun to your head and forcing you to buy products from corporations who have influence with government. That's what they're both about. We talk about the fact that the headlines say, Supreme Court upholds nationwide health care law subsidies, gives Obamacare a big win. Listen, they like to portray this as these are subsidies for individuals. These are subsidies, folks, for the insurance companies. They're the ones who get to set the rates. They set the rates high. They set it for certain things that you would not normally buy. Like if you are a single male, you're not going to buy maternity coverage unless you're buying it as part of Obamacare. Then you will pay for that. They will set the rates for that. This is a massive transfer of wealth from the individuals to the insurance companies. And that's what these subsidies are really subsidizing. They're not subsidizing your health care. They're subsidizing your insurance that was fixed by these insurance companies, telling you what you're going to buy and what you can't buy. And again, it doesn't really matter what the law is when you've got a government that doesn't pay any attention to it. That's what Scalia is saying. He says, we ought to start calling this law SCOTUS care. Now, of course, SCOTUS is the Supreme Court of the U.S. That's the abbreviation where they talk about it. He says, this is a defense of the indefensible. He says, rather than rewriting the law, this is Supreme Court Justice Scalia. He says, rather than rewriting the law, which is what they did, under the pretense of interpreting it, the court should have left it to Congress to decide what to do about the act's limitation of tax credits to state exchanges. But instead, they just pretend it doesn't say what it clearly says. For example, okay, when you look at this law, they have they say Congress would have had to amend the Affordable Care Act. So they put it in there that there would be state subsidies. States did not enact those subsidies. So rather than going back and following a constitutional process to go back and fix the law, like Congress has the duty to do, instead, they just take it with the Supreme Court and say, we're going to pretend that it says something that it doesn't really say so that you don't have to go through that legal process. So they say Congress would have had to amend the Affordable Care Act to fix the, quote, established by the state, unquote, language, a politically treacherous and likely untenable action in a Republican Congress. So it'd be a bit of a bother, and you know, it might not really pass. So let's just say that it means something that it doesn't mean, that it clearly doesn't mean. This is what one of the attorneys for the challenger said. If the rule of law means anything, it is that text is not infinitely malleable, that agencies must follow the law as written, not revise it to better achieve what they assume Congress had as a purpose. Yeah, but that's not the world that we currently live in. That's the world we're going to live in. We're going to make that happen with your help. Stay with us. We're going to be joined in the next segment. Michael Snyder is going to join us from the economiccollapseblog.com. Now, we cover a lot of his articles. End of the American Dream is another website that he writes on and publishes articles from. Here's some a sample of just some of the articles that he's had in the last week. Why is NASA working on a way to destroy asteroids using nuclear weapons? Does the IMF actually want to cause a Greek debt default? Warren Buffett says derivatives are still weapons of mass destruction, and they're likely to cause big trouble. 12 signs the U.S. and China are moving towards war. And then one, Lindsey Williams, Martin Armstrong, and Alex Jones all warn about what is coming in the fall of 2015. We're going to talk to him in the next segment. This segment, I want to talk a little bit about the war on the press, because that is key for the people who are, it's an information war, folks. We talk about this all the time, and one of the ways that they're going to win the war is if they keep us in the dark, if they keep us ignorant. Here's an article from Reason, how the feds asked me to rat out commentators. And this is kind of interesting. He had a comment on May 31st. He blogged about a life sentence that was given to Ross Ulbricht, the creator of the dark web site Silk Road. Now, we've interviewed his mother several times. We talked about that. Of course, he was given a draconian sentence of life in prison. In the comment section, a lot of people were angry at the judge, Catherine Force. In the comment section, he said there's half dozen commenters unloaded on the judge, suggesting, among other things, that she should burn in hell, be taken out, and shot. Another one, in an internet homage to the Coen brothers, said she ought to be fed feet first into a wood chipper. Of course, that's referring to the movie Fargo. He says, for starters, the subpoena was unnecessary because the comments obviously were not real. One of the commenters scooped up in this had written, I hope there's a special place in hell reserved for that horrible woman. Now, think about it, that the government would demand to know who this is when somebody makes a hyperbolic comment like that. Do you find that frightening? Okay, well then look at what happened to James O'Keefe. He got stopped coming back into the country. This is an article we have up on Infowars.com. Customs agents stopped him. He said, why am I being singled out? Why am I being detained? And of course, they said, well, it's because you crossed the border and filmed yourself doing it without our permission. And then, of course, they show a picture of a big X on his documents there that they they put in there. And they said, you're going to be stopped every time you come through the border. I guess that'll teach him, won't it? Okay? So another intimidation. And then, of course, there's this as well. We see yesterday the Department of Defense outlined laws of war and came up with an interesting label. So they've got three different categories. This is a large document, a very, very large document, just written, the Department of Defense Law of War Manual. I think it's about 1,000 pages. And basically, they break down the legal guidelines for all the branches of the military. When they get to the section on journalists, and it's kind of interesting that they would even add a section on journalists, they break down journalists into three categories, essentially. Members of the armed forces, so there's then those who are authorized to accompany the armed forces, those who are embedded, and then unprivileged belligerents. So you're either with us or you're an unprivileged belligerent, because you're either military or you're embedded with the military as a reporter, or you are an unprivileged belligerent. What is an unprivileged belligerent? Well, an unprivileged belligerent is somebody who is essentially, in the past, has been a spy. That's the way they view journalists that are not under their control, a potential spy, a potential risk, a security threat. There's two sections for those people. Journalists, and the first, the section 4.24.4 says journalists and spying. See, you're a spy if you're not embedded with them. So to avoid being mistaken for spies, journalists should act openly and with the permission of the authorities. Same thing goes for the next section, security precautions. See, states may need to censor journalists, so they need to make sure at all times they have the permission of the government. Sorry, First Amendment doesn't say that. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with Michael Snyder. Here in Austin, we're joined now by Michael Snyder. And Michael Snyder is someone that we have included his articles frequently on Infowars.com. We have just a sample of a couple of articles in the last few days. Why is NASA working on a way to destroy asteroids using nuclear weapons? Does the IMF actually want to cause a Greek debt default? Lindsey Williams, Martin Armstrong, and Alex Jones all warn about what's coming in the fall of 2015. So we're going to be talking to Michael Snyder. I want to go to him in just a moment. Before I do, we've been talking about how we're trying to grow this operation, how we're in a fight to stop the effects of TPP. If we can't completely stop TPP from passing, the fast track has gone through. It's going to be more difficult to stop it. We're going to have to fight harder than ever. One way that you can do this, of course, is to follow us at Prison Planet TV. Become a subscriber. Support our operation. There's no question that we're making a difference, but you can make a difference if you support us financially. If you become a subscriber, you don't have to wait for low-quality uploads on YouTube that are going to come out the next day. You can just log in. You can watch it on HD. You can watch it live right now. You can try it for 14 days. If you like it, it's only $5 a month, and it supports our entire operation here. So that's one way that you can join the fight. It's one way that you can educate other people. And, of course, we have many different ways to educate people. One of those is Michael Snyder's articles that we post up on Infowars.com. He's the creator of the EconomicCollapseBlog.com. He is not a member of any political party, he points out, or any political organization. He is very pessimistic about what's going on. I should say bearish is probably a better word. He also writes endoftheamericandream.com, thetruthwins.com. There's a positive one for you. Author of two books, Beginning of the End and Get Prepared. See, if you're looking at this from a bearish perspective, just like Max Kaiser, we had him on a couple of days ago. He's a bear. He's got that on his social media, his website. He's got a picture of a bear behind his picture. That's preparing for the worst case scenario. That's what we really need to prepare for. So joining us now is Michael Snyder. Welcome, Michael.
Thank you. It's a real privilege to be on with you.
We read your articles all the time, so it's interesting to see what you look like and to get a chance to talk to you. What do you want to cover first? Because we've just seen the Trans-Pacific Partnership, not partnership, I make that mistake again. We saw the fast track go through. We're going to see these trade treaties that they've been working on. They're going to try to ram them through very rapidly. What is your feeling on this? What's your take?
Yeah, well, a lot of people out there have been waiting for a one-world economic system to come someday. But to me, it's here now, and this is another huge step toward integrating the U.S. economy with the entire globe. In fact, the TPP will cover 40% of the entire GDP of the entire planet. And then the plan is eventually to get China and the EU and everyone else along with it too, to make it a truly global treaty. Mm-hmm. Well, what this treaty is going to mean is it's going to mean the loss of more jobs, more manufacturing facilities. Already we've seen more than 56,000 manufacturing facilities shut down in the United States since 2001. We've lost millions of jobs. We've seen our economic infrastructure absolutely get gutted. And this is going to take it to an entirely new level. Every single treaty that comes along, whether it's NAFTA, whether it's CAFTA, whatever it is, it's always meant less jobs for American workers. It's always meant more jobs, more businesses going overseas. So this is just another step in that direction. And then the other thing that infuriates me about this is that this treaty is not just about economics and trade. That's only a small part of it. It's also about the environment. It's about intellectual property. It's about the internet. It's about derivatives. It's about education. It's about so many other things.
That's so true. And, you know, the sad thing about it is you started out talking about how it is global governance. And, of course, Senator Jeff Sessions pointed that out. He's not anybody who believes, he's not a 9/11 truther. He's not somebody that is out there that's been talking about a new world government. But he looked at the agreement and he said, look, they're creating a transnational committee that is going to have the power to write its own laws without any input from us. This is global governance. And so when we fight against this just by talking about the negative economic consequences, and we've seen how these economic consequences have worked out for us with NAFTA, if we just fight against it on that basis alone, though, we're fighting it with one hand behind our back, aren't we?
Oh, we absolutely are. And what infuriates me is that the Republicans have been the ones pushing for this, pushing so hard to give Obama this authority to negotiate this comprehensive treaty in secrecy. It's an ultra secret treaty. Members of Congress actually have to go into a basement room to read this treaty. They're handed one section at a time where they're able to go through with someone actually looking over their shoulder as they read it. When they're done, they have to hand it back when they leave the room. And when they come out of the room and go back, they're not allowed to tell any of us, they're not allowed to tell the public what's actually in this treaty. So do we still live in a republic? This is so absolutely absurd. And so what Barack Obama is almost assuredly doing is everything he couldn't get through Congress before, everything that he always wanted to do, he's sticking into this treaty, putting into this treaty. And the Republicans are saying, yeah, let's go ahead and give him this authority to negotiate this super huge treaty, which is going to lock us in. And then this treaty is going to say the only way that it can be changed is with the permission of all the other countries that are parties to the treaty. So it's really insidious.
Well, with the permission of that transnational committee, which presumes to represent all those other countries. You know, one of the things that we need to do, I think, Michael, is we need to, the Republicans are signing on to this. In many cases, the rank and file say, well, I support free trade. They need to understand this is not free trade any more than crony capitalism and what we saw happen with the banks. That's not a free market. Okay, so understand this is not free trade by any stretch of the imagination. And they also need to understand, I think you're talking about all these different issues that are already a part of it based on the leaks that we've seen. They can bring in things like gun control. We've seen the UN Arms Trade Treaty that Obama is desperate to pass, that John Kerry said he signed on behalf of the American people. Of course, we had Senator Corker from Tennessee say, I'm sorry, that's not the way the law works. But they are willing to, you know, bend the Constitution to their will. We see this over and over again. We just saw it in the Supreme Court decision today. It doesn't matter what the language says. They're going to use any kind of pretense or prevarication to do what they want to do. So we should be very concerned, and we ought to get Republicans on board with this, saying, look, this is going to affect gun control quite possibly. This is something that's been going down the pike for several years as well.
Yeah, absolutely. We truly have become a lawless land. And we saw this with the Supreme Court decision today about Obamacare, with Chief Justice Roberts once again stepping up to defend Obamacare. And I warned at the time he was nominated, this is a progressive. This is not someone that has a respect for a constitution. But all the conservatives out there, because he was nominated by a Republican, they thought, oh, this is a good justice. He's going to stand up for the Constitution. But that, I said, no, that's not going to be the case. And that's turned out not to be the case. Now, what a lot of people out there may not realize is that I actually have a law degree. I went to law school, the University of Florida Law School, and then I went on to practice law right in the heart of Washington, D.C., down on K Street. And what people need to realize is that in our law schools all over this country and courts all over this land, a lot of times these court decisions, these judges, what they do is they decide what they want to rule, how they want to rule, and then they fish for any kind of possible justification they can to come to that end result. That's
absolutely
what we've seen with this latest decision, and we've seen it with a whole series of decisions. So we, you know, the respect for the Constitution has really gone out the window.
Oh, absolutely. Drudge had an article up yesterday talking about how the Supreme Court under Roberts had moved quite a bit to the left, and they ranked it by all these different decisions, and that was before today's move. And so Drudge put that up as a headline today, the court swings far to the left. I think that's really true, and it underscores the nonsense of thinking that you're going to, that the Republican Party, that a Supreme Court nominee from a Republican president are going to vote the way you want them to vote. Look, these guys are tools of the corporations. Take a look at the Keystone Pipeline, for example. Okay, the Republicans have passed that 10 times. They still haven't gotten it through, but they've passed that 10 times. And we could have a discussion about oil and about pollution and sources of oil and that kind of stuff. But the thing that concerns me about the Keystone Pipeline, again, is this supranational idea that the corporations rule. And you can see that already as they got close to passing this. They gave TransCanada, which is running the Keystone Pipeline, they gave them eminent domain to condemn and seize the farms of people who are going to be in the path of the pipeline. People who've had this, their farms in their family for over 100 years. They gave that to a corporation. This is far beyond the Kelo decision, where the Supreme Court said was okay, where they had a local government take from one individual and give to another individual private property, not for public use, but for private use. Now, this is something that is giving, not only extending that, but extending it to a foreign corporation, giving the foreign corporation the power to condemn and to take for that corporation's benefit. That's amazing to me. But we see the Republicans lining up to do that. We see the Republicans refusing to take on Obamacare. And we see the Supreme Court saying, hey, you know, this would be a difficult thing if we had to actually rewrite the law to do what we wanted to do. So let's just have the Supreme Court wave their magic wand over it and say these words don't mean what these words mean.
Oh, absolutely. And when I was in law school, when people go to law school, most Americans don't realize, but our law students are being taught and trained that the Constitution is a living, breathing document. In other words, that it can change with the times, that you know, and the attitude that we law students are taught in law school is that we know better than those who framed the Constitution. We know better than previous generations of Americans. We're progressing toward the future. Essentially, law schools are kind of seminaries for progressives in which we're ingrained with progressivism. Now, of course, I never embraced that, but I saw it happening all around me. And all of my law professors, almost every single one, was a hardcore progressive.
Hang on right there. We got to go to break. Michael Snyder will be right back. We're going to talk about postmodernism, the malleable constitution. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight in Austin, and we're joined by Michael Snyder, an author that we pick up frequently at Infowars.com. He writes for the Economic Collapse blog.com, and we're going to talk to him about economic collapse, what he sees in the near future, his concerns, and also what he thinks the timing may be. In the last segment, we were talking about the Supreme Court decision that just came out in terms of Obamacare. As Justice Scalia said, let's call it SCOTUS care, because they are essentially writing the laws and moving the words of the law to suit themselves. He said it's not a malleable document. And Michael is a lawyer by training, and he was just talking about how they're training the lawyers in law school now to see the Constitution as a living document. Jeff Sessions is a lawyer. He's a judge, and he looked at the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and he was appalled by the fact that it itself was a living document, something that could be infinitely changed without any due process by any involvement by any of the nations that had signed onto it. It was going to be a transnational committee that was going to be free to change this. Of course, they're going to present it as a complete package to the House and to the Senate. Once it is passed, again, they're not going to be able to make any amendments. Once it is passed, that international committee is going to be able to change it at will. But I want to get back to what you were talking about, because it was exactly what Scalia was talking about today, how they're teaching the law school students that the Constitution is a malleable document, kind of this postmodern subjective outlook on it.
Yeah, and if you go to and look at federal court decisions today, sometimes they even go to international law or international standards of morality, they call it, to justify their decisions. They even go outside of the United States. So anything they can reach for and grasp, and they talk about changing public values, changing public opinions. And so I expect to see something similar within the next few days regarding the upcoming decision about gay marriage, which I fully expect to be declared a constitutional right, even though the Constitution says nothing of the sort, no language in there which could possibly be used to justify such a thing. But I fully expect that it will be termed a fundamental right, will be the technical language that will be used. And I fully expect the Supreme Court to make it the law of the land in all 50 states. But the reason they're doing it is because that's the decision they want to come to.
Yes.
And I believe Justice Roberts will once again side on that. But they're making things up out of thin air. That's what people need to realize.
Yeah, the Constitution says that the central government doesn't have any powers unless they are explicitly granted to it. And of course, they will play games with things like the Commerce Clause, which I kind of find interesting, Michael, because, you know, the Commerce Clause was originally there to create free trade. You know, it was originally there to stop the different states from imposing taxes as goods were crossing from, let's say, Texas into Oklahoma. They were going to say, no, Oklahoma is not going to be able to put an import tax on those goods. So they put the Commerce Clause in there to create free trade. And the government has turned that on its head and used it to not only control trade, but to involve themselves in pretty much every aspect of our lives. And of course, that's the kind of prevarications, the kind of lies and perversions that they use. There's absolutely nothing in the Constitution that gives the government, the central government, control over defining marriage. Of course, they don't even have any control over prohibiting drugs. They had to have a constitutional amendment to prohibit alcohol, and then another one to make it legal again. At least in the early 20th century, we had people in Washington who paid respect to the formalities of the law. We no longer have that. If they don't want you to have something, they just say you can't have it. If they want you to buy a product from one of their corporate sponsors, they mandate it. That's where we are today.
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, it's absolutely insane what's happening, you know, to the Constitution and to the rule of law. And I think it's only going to get worse. I recently wrote an article about the emergency powers that our presidents have, and Obama has more than ever before. And federal courts have consistently sided with the presidency, even though the Constitution says nothing about emergency powers. But today, Barack Obama is the most powerful president in all of U.S. history, thanks not only to executive orders, but statutory law and a whole bunch of other things and precedents that have been set in courts. If we have a major national emergency, it's at the point where the groundwork has already been laid for Barack Obama to essentially be a dictator and take control of basically whatever he wants and to do basically whatever he wants. All we need is one major national crisis, and he already has the groundwork, the legal authority, although he really, you know, according to the Constitution, he wouldn't. But the groundwork has been laid in the courts for him to take control basically of everything.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And that's what you wind up with when you throw out the objective truth of written law and you make it a living document. Then it is whatever the people say it is. It's whatever the leader says it is. That's the definition of a dictator. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with Michael Snyder. We're going to talk about what he sees as the coming collapse as well as the timing. Let's go to Michael Snyder. Michael, you're looking at, you believe that there's going to be an economic collapse soon. You take a bearish outlook on things. You prepare for the future. What do you see coming, and when do you see it coming?
Well, as a lawyer, I was trained to be level-headed. As a lawyer, I was trained to come to conclusions based on the evidence. Now, I've been doing the economiccollapseblog.com since 2009. And all during that time, I've never issued any kind of alert of any sort. But today, on the Alex Jones Show, I am announcing that I am issuing a red alert for the last 6 months of 2015, I believe that a financial collapse, similar to what we saw back in 2008, a global financial collapse is imminent. And when I say imminent, I don't believe, I'm not saying in the next 48 hours. What I'm saying is within the next 6 months, I believe we have entered, we are entering a danger zone similar to what we entered in 2008. I believe that we are looking at the one of the greatest financial bubbles in all of history, and I believe it's about to burst.
Yeah, it certainly looks like that from the preparations that our government has been making. Either they are the most paranoid people the planet has ever seen, or they've been seeing some kind of an economic collapse coming for quite some time. And we saw this a couple of years ago when they started buying massive quantities of ammunition. And of course, it was hollow point ammunition, which is outlawed for use by the military, but it's permitted for use against civilian populations by governments. And it's also the most expensive ammunition that you can buy. So they're not getting it for target practice. So we saw them stockpiling that. We see them pushing out military equipment to all of the Mayberry police departments, all the small town police departments, getting these MRAPs and armored vehicles, militarizing the police. It certainly looks like they are preparing either for a collapse or a crackdown.
Yeah. And if you just look at the technical indicators, my undergraduate degree, before I went to law school, my undergraduate degree is actually in business. And in business school, if you took the last 6 months of what's happened in the financial world, it would be a textbook case for a run-up to a stock market crash. For example, if you look at the Buffett indicator, it's a ratio of corporate equities to GDP. It's the highest it's ever been in modern American history. The only time, except for one time, the only time it's been higher was right before the dot-com bubble burst in the year 2000. Or if you look at price to earnings ratios, right now the price to earnings ratios over the last 6 months, the only times they've ever been higher in all of US history were in 1929, right before the stock market crashed, and in the year 2000, right before the stock market crashed, were higher than we were even before the 2008 crash. Or if you take a look at margin debt, in all of modern American history, there's been three great peaks of margin debt. In other words, people are borrowing awesome, tremendous amounts of money to buy stocks with, which is a really bad idea, but they're doing it. The first major peak was right before the dot-com bubble burst. It peaked like crazy, and then the market crashed. It peaked right before the 2008 crash. We saw a massive peak in margin debt, then the market crashed. And now the third great peak, in fact, it recently hit a brand new record high. We're also seeing a great divergence between the S&P 500 and high yield credit or high yield bonds. This is something we saw in the run up to 2008 crash, where usually junk bonds and the stock market, they track each other very closely. But then leading up to 2008, we saw them start to diverge. The stock market kept going up while the junk bonds started to fall ahead of the crash. And so that's happening again. And we're seeing so many other of these indicators, like just like we saw in 2008, where we've had an oil price crash. We've seen a whole bunch of these other indicators start to happen with the U.S. dollar rising, commodities prices going down. So many of them that have happened before that are happening once again. So leading up to this, it's a textbook case for what we would expect leading up to a stock market crash.
And, you know, you had a over the weekend, we had an article that you had written that we put up on Infowars.com. Lindsey Williams, Martin Armstrong, and Alex Jones all warn about what is coming in the fall of 2015. And, of course, Alex had interviewed Martin Armstrong. He predicted very accurately previous market activity with his econometric model. We had that video, and when you look at what's happening, when you look at all the different indicators that you're looking at, and even the broader, simpler indicators of the fact that they keep pumping money into the world economy and it isn't doing anything. It's just laying there dead. They can't take the interest rates any lower to stimulate the economy. They're talking about negative interest rates. They're talking about currency controls. They're getting very desperate. We see this happening across the board. People who don't own stocks need to understand that if you even have any money that's going to get locked up if we have an economic collapse like this, they're already putting the pieces into place to lock up your cash, to confiscate your cash out of the out of your bank account. That's what people are afraid of in Greece. That's why they pulled out over 4 billion euros in just 1 week in Greece, because they thought that was going to happen this last week. We still don't know what's going to happen in Greece.
Oh, absolutely. And but the, what's happening in Greece now is just a preview of what's coming to the entire planet. Here in the United States, the as you mentioned, the velocity of money has dropped to the lowest level in modern American history. Normally, in a healthy economy, money flows very freely. I buy something from you, you buy something from someone else, and money circulates. But in an unhealthy economy, the velocity of money goes down. And we've seen the velocity of money keep dropping and dropping and dropping. Now it's the lowest level it's been in modern American history. And so, yes, as you mentioned, we've seen so many others start to say, start to point to the last half of this year. Lindsey Williams, he recently said this, quote, "My elite friend indicated that we that they have a worldwide financial collapse scheduled between September and the end of December 2015. Martin Armstrong, as you mentioned, he's been pointing to the year 2015.75 is what he calls it, referring to the fall of this year. He's been pointing to that. His economic model has been pointing to that for decades, actually, to this moment that's coming up. Alex Jones recently issued a video warning, which went viral all over the world, warning about what's coming next. Bible prophecy expert Joel Rosenberg, he recently issued a warning in which he said, quote, "Something is coming. I don't know what, but we all must be ready in every possible way." So it's not just me that's pointing to what's ahead. But all over the internet, prominent voices are speaking out, things I've been told publicly, things I've been told privately that I can't share at this time. What I'm basing this red alert, I've never done this before, but I'm issuing this red alert, not based on what one or two people are saying, not one on one or two indicators, but on the totality of what I've learned, the totality of my research, what I've been told. I've written more than 1,300 articles on the Economic Collapse blog alone about the coming financial crisis. But I've decided this is the moment to warn the people that a financial crisis is imminent, that it's coming, and it's not going to, our problems are not going to end at the end of 2015. This is going to lead into 2016 and beyond. I believe the worst period of time in modern American history is coming. As the next few years roll along. I know a lot of people, they've gotten complacent. They don't have a sense of urgency. A lot of preppers, they used to prep, but they say, oh, well, things seem like they're going to be okay, so I'm not going to do that anymore.
You get lured into this kind of complacency, don't you? Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. It's a normalcy bias where people think, well, nothing has happened, you know, so nothing is going to happen. But I'm telling you, we're heading for a cliff and we're about to go off.
You know, you talked about all these different indications. You talked about how Martin Armstrong's been talking about 2015.75, in other words, last quarter of 2015 for a long time. One of the first reports I did when I came to InfoWars was about a book called The Fourth Turning of Strauss and Howe. I don't know if you've heard of them or not, but of course they have a cyclical interpretation of history, and they take it back to the 1600s going through American and English history, looking at this generational cycle. There's like four generations, and like every year, 80 years, they see a massive upheaval, a massive change. They were saying 20 years ago that they were looking at a time frame that was around 2020 for a massive upheaval similar to the Civil War, similar to World War II, similar to the War of Independence. So, you know, they're looking at this type of upheaval. And at the same time, we've been hearing from all these futurists about 2020. 2020 is the year that all the robots are going to be online. We aren't going to have any jobs. I mean, we've seen all of these different projections from so many different corners, looking at the time period from about 2015 to 2025, where we are going to see this massive upheaval, massive revolution. So this is coming from a lot of different quarters.
Yeah, I even wrote an entire article about economic cycle theories. It's just not a couple of these. There's like, about six of these major theories, which all point to the period between 2015 and 2020 as a period of extreme upheaval, economic collapse, terrible times. So it's funny how all these theories from actually a secular point of view are pointing to this. Mm-hmm. And then on the alternative end, this time period also corresponds with them some things that people are pointing to spiritually. For example, we've got the end of the Shemitah cycle. Many of your listeners are probably familiar with this, the seven-year biblical cycle, which comes every 7 years. And the funny thing is, at the end of the last two Shemitah cycles, September 17th, 2001, was the last day of a Shemitah cycle, the seven-year biblical cycle. On the very last day, Elul 29 on the biblical calendar, the day right before Rosh Hashanah, we saw the greatest one-day stock market crash in all of U.S. history up until that time. And that record held for exactly 7 years until 7 years later, September 29th, 2008. Once again, Elul 29 on the biblical calendar, the day right before Rosh Hashanah, the Dow fell by 777 points. Once again, the greatest stock market crash in all of U.S. history up until that time. Now we're in a new Shemitah cycle. It began last fall. It ends on September 13th, 2015. Now that's a Sunday, so the stock market's not going to crash on that day. But we're coming up to the end of another one of these cycles. So many people are wondering what's going to happen.
That's very interesting. You know, you had when you start talking about cycles and signs. I thought it was very interesting, this article that you had just yesterday. Why is NASA working on a way to destroy asteroids using nuclear weapons? They're working with the National Nuclear Security Administration. I'd never even heard of that, Michael. They're working on a way straight out of the movies, as you pointed out, Armageddon and these other movies from 10, 20 years ago, where they would send a crew up to put nuclear explosives on an asteroid that was headed towards the Earth. Apparently, they're working on this now. This is reported by the New York Times that reported this?
Yeah, the New York Times reported how NASA is teaming up with the National Nuclear Security Administration to figure out a way to use nuclear weapons against asteroids. Well, immediately I had flashbacks to Deep Impact and Armageddon, a couple movies I loved back in the 1990s.
Yeah.
But this seems very, very strange to me, because just a couple weeks ago, NASA came out and said, they held a whole deal where they came out and publicly announced, quote, no asteroid or comet is currently on a collision course with Earth. And they also said, quote, no large object is likely to strike the Earth anytime in the next several hundred years. So that's what they said publicly, but then all of a sudden they're trying to figure out a way to destroy asteroids with nuclear weapons. Well, that would seem to me that that's a tremendous waste of time, effort, and money if there's absolutely no threat out there at all. And actually, earlier this year, NASA held a whole big practice scenario about what would happen if an asteroid was coming. So it seems like their actions and their words aren't quite matching up.
It's interesting when they make that pronouncement uninvited. Oh, I just want to let you know, you don't have anything to worry about this. Meanwhile, they're training for that. Stay with us. We're going to talk to Michael Schneider about what you can do. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Michael Schneider. I'm looking at Martin Armstrong's predictions here. Michael Schneider is joining us from the economiccollapseblog.com. He's a frequent contributor to Infowars.com. We've been talking about some of his recent articles. And of course, in the last segment, we were talking about how technocrats and globalists like Ray Kurzweil have been looking forward to the time frame between 2015 and 2025, where they were going to see massive societal change. We've seen the same thing from people who observe cycles of history, cycles within society. People like Strauss and Howe, who wrote the fourth turning being the fourth generation, where you have massive upheaval, usually resulting, not always, but usually resulting in a massive war, something like World War II. And then, of course, we also have different economic indicators that are all lining up. That was what Michael Schneider was just talking about, Martin Armstrong's cycles, all the different stock market indicators that start to point to an economic collapse this year, latter part of the fall, as well as some of the biblical cycles pointing to this upcoming September as being a significant time. So I want to talk to you, Michael, about what people should do to prepare. Give us an idea, because you've been thinking about this. You are a bear on this. You are preparing what to do. You wrote a book called Get Prepared. Tell us what to do, what people should be doing to prepare for this kind of upheaval.
Yeah, in order to get prepared, a lot of it is common sense. For example, I encourage people to have an emergency fund that can cover at least 6 months of your bills so that if you do lose a job, if your business goes sour, that you're going to be able to pay the mortgage, you're going to be able to pay the bills, you're going to be able to survive in the midst of chaos all around us. You know, because a survey came out just the other day, 30% of Americans don't have a single penny of savings, of emergency savings. So when the crisis comes, what's going to happen to them? They're going to be, it's going to be a disaster almost immediately. I'm also a big believer in storing up food and supplies and everything that you would need for a longer term crisis. Now that's a little bit more down the road, but I'm a big believer of that. And anything you can do to become more independent of the system, learning to grow a garden, that's a way to become less dependent on the system, having your own fruits and vegetables so you don't have to go and get them at the store, whatever you can do for home security and self-defense. I believe we're moving into a time we're going to see great civil unrest in our cities. Crime is going to rise. People are going to become more desperate. So you need to start thinking about how, what are you going to do for your own home defense, things of that nature. But then let me talk about financial preparation, because that's what a lot of people are concerned about. Our banking system, our financial system is extremely vulnerable. So you don't want to be exposed to the stock market. You don't want to be have a retirement plan, which is potentially exposed. And you don't want to put all of your eggs in one basket or one bank. Because let me tell you a little bit about the banks. Today, you know, the last crisis, the banks were played a starring role in it. They're right at the center. And we are told the problem of too big to fail would be solved. Well, unfortunately, it hasn't been solved. In fact, it's gotten even worse. In fact, since the last crisis, the four largest banks in the United States have collectively gotten 40% larger. Meanwhile, 1,400 smaller banks have totally gone out of existence. So the problem of too big to fail is now greater than ever. But meanwhile, these big banks, you know, they're so important. They made mistakes last time. You think they would learn their lessons? No. Instead, they become far more reckless than ever. In fact, five of the too big to fail banks I'm talking about, JP Morgan Chase, Citibank, Goldman Sachs, Bank of America, Morgan Stanley, each one of them has exposure to derivatives of at least $38 trillion. JP Morgan Chase, the biggest, has total exposure to derivatives of more than $63 trillion, while they only have total assets of about $2.6 trillion.
Amazing. So that's very important information. We're out of time, Michael. I wish we had more time. Michael Snyder, theeconomiccollapseblog.com, and of course you can catch him on Infowars.com frequently. Tonight's Nightly News. Thank you for joining us, Michael. Tonight's Nightly News. Michael, Derrick Green will be hosting. Join us then.
You are listening to GCN. Visit GCNlive.com today.